Good morning, brethren in the Lord. I want to appreciate you for joining me this morning. This is the sense of Zion, a Christian organization created to raise the sense of heaven and to restore men's fellowship back to God. You have come to the right place, and I believe that your life will be transformed. Actually, this morning we'll be having a study of a book, Fellowship with God, by Idoko, Meshach. And it's a study that will help us get more closer to God. It's a study that will build up our passion, our interest, and our zeal for God. And I believe that as we go along with this study, the Spirit of the Lord will reveal a lot of secrets regarding our fellowship with God. As we see today in our world, many people have neglected the place of God. Many people no longer have this passion to fellowship with God. And this is why this book has been written by the author, to stir up and trigger that passion in men's heart again to fellowship with God. So what we'll be doing this morning is to take the preface of the book and the introduction. So remain connected with me as we read along. Now the preface. Fellowship with God provides the fundamental truth as regards your work with God. It is birthed out of the passion to fill the earth with the knowledge of the Lord as the water covers the sea. It is my desire that all men be drawn to the Lord. I want everyone in the world to have a copy of this book. I want everyone to read the content of this book and live by the precepts given by the Holy Spirit. Right from childhood, it has always been my ambition for the world to hear what the Spirit is saying. And this is one out of many, and I believe everyone who will read and take up these words to their heart and live by them will be transformed and enjoying sweet fellowship with God. A look at this book will open your mind to the truths that will trigger your desire and hunger to fellowship with God. To truly understand what it means to fellowship with God, then follow me through. Now, the contents or the chapters that we'll be considering in this book, the first chapter will be Without Excuses. Is God really interested in me? You are special to God. God's provision to reconciliation, or God's provision of reconciliation, the essence of our existence, where do you belong? What you need most, fellowship with God, the habit of relationship with God, developing a devotional habit, how to develop a dynamic prayer life, fellowship with brethren, benefit of fellowship with God, words of assurance, wise sayings, and adoration and worship. You can see that what we have in this book is actually loaded, and it's going to be very, very practical. How do you enjoy this dynamic walk with God? That's what we want to look at. How do you enjoy your fellowship with God? Because it is very, very critical. We have established the fact that our Christianity is not just about religion, but it's about having a personal knowledge of God, having a personal fellowship with God. But now, the challenge we have in our generation today is people struggle with their fellowship with God. People struggle with their prayer life. People struggle with studying the word. So this book is going to help us to revive our spirit again to fellowship with God. So let's go to the introduction. I would like to start this book by bringing here what Dr. David Feddy said about our world today. It is a pity that we have missed it. All we see happening around us today is because we have rejected God. We have not given God the glory due him. We have trusted in our wisdom and has gone astray. But coming back to God in fellowship is just the solution to this problem. Now listen to what David Feddy said. David Feddy is actually the Vice President of Academics and the Provost of Christian Leaders Institute in the United States of America. Without excuses, this is how he puts it. Once upon a time, there was a land where people saw God's hand in almost everything. They looked at animals and mountains, at stars and rainbows, at sunshine and cornfields, and saw the hand of God. They looked at great events of history and saw the hand of God. They looked at their own lives and saw the hand of God. Most people prayed in their homes. They worshipped in church every Sunday. They sent their children to schools and started each day with prayer and thought about God and thought the difference between right and wrong. But then, things began to change. It happened, even in our time today. If we compare the present and the past, we see that a lot of things have changed. In the past, where we see people giving God glory, giving Him stuff, they talked about the laws of nature. Instead of thanking God for the good things they enjoy, they spoke of how they had earned it all through hard work. A deadly chain reaction followed. A deadly chain reaction. Now, after a while, the old beliefs about God began to seem rather quiet. Why suppose there was a creator at all? Couldn't everything have come into being just by chance? Soon, some of the smarter people came up with a whole new theory to explain everything without even mentioning God. Then somebody decided that schools must teach this new theory to all the children and not allow anyone to pray openly. Teachers weren't allowed to talk about God or to teach right and wrong based on faith in God. Meanwhile, as schools banned all mention of God, churches started producing up-to-date gods and goddesses that would make people more comfortable than they were with the old God who insisted on holiness. Now, as the old faith faded, there was a sexual revolution. The new commandment was, if it feels good, do it. It began to seem unfair to insist that sex is for married people. It seemed cruel to deprive single people of such a fun activity. For that matter, why limit married people to the same person their whole life? Therefore, it became common as more and more decided they would be happier with a new mate. After that sexual revolution came a second sexual revolution. The whole notion of male and female seemed outdated. Women became sexually involved with other women, men with other men. Some had hundreds of different partners. They even had parades and special events to celebrate all this. We can see what the world is turning into. Such behavior had once been considered unnatural and wrong, but now anyone who spoke against such behavior was considered unnatural and wrong. We can see that abnormalities now is becoming normal, and the unnatural things are becoming natural to us. Some nasty diseases spread rapidly as a result of the new attitude towards sex. But few people wanted to change their behavior. They just wanted a cure for the diseases. Somewhere along the line, people decided they didn't want to recognize any moral absolutes at all. More and more things that were once thought wicked and unmentionable became mainstream. Their favorite motto was, nobody's going to tell me what to do. People became more and more money hungry, and in their greed, they didn't care whom they ripped off or stomped on to get ahead. It seemed everybody wanted what somebody else had. Violence, crime, and murder grew more and more common. Lawsuits jammed the court. Conflict became a way of life at every level of society. Lying became so common that nobody's word carried any weight. Anything important had to be written in a contract, and even contract didn't count for much. The whole atmosphere became malicious. Gossip and slander were everywhere, in politics and in private life. It seemed as though people had no conscience anymore. If anyone dared to challenge the I can do as I please attitude in the name of God, people just hated God all the more. They hated authority of every kind. Young people became more and more deviant and rebellious towards their parents. Those who bragged the loudest and invented the most outlandish behavior were often admired for having real attitude like we have today. You see, whereby celebrities are showcasing some of this wayward kind of life, and that's what people are going for. Whether in a street gang or a business corporation, nastiness was the way to get respect. That's how we see it. In this deadly chain reaction, one thing led to another. So we can see that it's actually a deadly chain reaction. Things are getting worse and worse every day. Things went from bad to worse until God considered, things went from bad to worse until people considered God a joke and applauded ungodliness. Now, there was still a valued memory of God and of His warning that sin leads to death and hell. But most people just laughed at old beliefs about fire and brimstone. They not only did bad things, but flaunted their behavior openly and made celebrities out of those who lived on the wild side. God's wrath revealed. Now let's look at God's wrath revealed, because God cannot just sit down and look at all these things happening and be quiet. Now, what happens? Does any of this sound familiar? It might sound like a fairy, like a fair summary of what's been going on in our society over that last several decades. But I didn't get the sequence of events from reading newspapers or watching TV. I got it from the Bible. Everything I've mentioned is found in Romans chapter 1, in the very order I've just described. The scariest thing about all this is that when the Bible describes this deadly chain reaction, it says that these are progressive symptoms of a society. That's what the Bible says in Romans chapter 1, verse 18 to 32. Now let's read the Bible. The Bible says, "The wrath of God is being revealed from heaven against all the godlessness and wickedness of men." Now, let's take note of that. "Against all the godlessness and wickedness of men who suppress the truth by their wickedness, since what may be known about God is plain to them, because God has made it plain to them. For since the creation of the world, God's invisible qualities, His eternal power and divine nature have been clearly seen, being understood from what has been made, so that men are without excuse. For although they knew God, they neither glorified Him as God nor gave thanks to Him. But their thinking became futile, and their foolish hearts were darkened. Although they claimed to be wise, they became fools and exchanged the glory for images made to look like mortal man and birds and animals and reptiles. Therefore, God gave them over in the sinful desire to sexual impurity for the degrading of their bodies with one another. They exchanged the truth of God for a lie and worshipped and served created things rather than the Creator, who is forever praised. Amen. Because of this, God gave them over to shameful lust." Now, when the Bible talks about God giving people over to something, it simply means it's like God has been given warning over and over again, but men being rebellious to His instructions. It's like, okay, continue with whatever you want to do. Even their women exchange natural relations for natural ones. In the same way, the men also abandon natural relations with women and were inflamed with lust for one another. Men committed indecent acts with other men and received in themselves the due penalty for their perversion. So we see today homosexuality, we see lesbianism and every kind of sexual immorality as we see in our time today. Now furthermore, since they did not think it worthwhile to retain the knowledge of God, He gave them over to a depraved mind to do what ought not to be done. So when God gives people over to such things, because of rebelliousness, they have become filled with every kind of wickedness, evil, greed, and depravity. They are full of envy, murder, strife, deceit, and malice. They are gossips, slanderers, God-haters, insolent, arrogant, and boastful. They invent ways of doing evil. They disobey their parents. They are senseless, faithless, heartless, ruthless. Although they know God's righteous decree that those who do such things deserve death, they not only continue to do these very things, but also approve of those who practice them. Now, isn't it chilling to hear such an exact description of where we find ourselves? First, people know God, but suppress what they know. And they refuse to thank Him or give Him the honor He deserves. Then they come up with new theories about creation, leaving the Creator out of the picture. Then sexual looseness becomes common, followed by approval of gay and lesbian coupling. Finally, the entire social structure starts crumbling as everybody does what they please. The whole mess wrecks of death and decay. But still, the people act like this is normal. And that's the strange thing of it all. What does it mean? It means we're in deep trouble. That's the truth. We're actually in deep trouble. According to Romans chapter 1, these are the progressive symptoms of a society under God's wrath. In hearing about this revelation of wrath, we hear three things. Now, what are these three things? The same dreadful refrain. We hear God saying, God gave them over. God gave them over. God gave them over. It was repeated three times in that same chapter. The Lord shows his anger by letting people think their own thoughts and go their own way. The Lord shows his anger by letting people go further and further away from his light, further and further into darkness and ruin. We are a society under God's rule. Politicians and pundits, psychologists and sociologists can offer explanation for the breakdown of the family and the disintegration of the social fabric. And those explanations may have a bit of truth here and there, but the core of the matter is this: we are a society under God's rule. All the symptoms are there exactly as the word describes them, the word of God describes them. No other explanation would do. Now you ask the question, what is the root cause? Why are things like that? Now, a lot of people these days are concerned about crime and family problems and the various ways our society and our personal life seem to be disintegrating. And they would like to do something about it. They would like to build more prisons or get rid of guns or improve education or emphasize sexual morality or crusade against drugs and gangs or teach our children about creation or get prayer back in the schools. Some of these things might be okay, but they only deal with the symptoms, not actually the root of the problem. They don't address the root cause. According to Romans chapter 1, all our problems are part of a deadly chain reaction set off by our most basic problem. And what's that problem? We have rejected. So you can see, the whole issue, the whole problem that we are facing in our world, in our generation today is just simple. We have rejected God. And that has brought us under his wrath. The first step in obtaining God's mercy, because that is the only thing that can save us, is seeing our need of it. We have to acknowledge that we've actually gone wrong. We have to see that we are actually in a problem. Not taking our problem to be the way of life, and that's the big challenge. Before we can escape the mess we're in, we must know how we got ourselves into it in the first place. We must face the fact without any excuses. Creation shines with the power and divine splendor of our God, but sinful people don't want to acknowledge him. So they suppress and distort the signals that creation sends them about God. And what's the result? Romans 1 says that this provokes God's wrath, and God reveals his wrath by letting them go from bad to worse. He hands them over to themselves and let them sink deeper and deeper into their own mess. The whole mess begins with a refusal to acknowledge God and give him the praise and thanks he deserves. Now, that's the source of all the other problems. Now, Romans chapter 1 verse 18 says that God's wrath is revealed against godlessness and wickedness. So you can see what triggered the wrath of God. It was just godlessness and wickedness. The order in which those two words occur is very, very important. Godlessness comes before wickedness. There are many types of wickedness, but they are all symptoms of the same problem, which is godlessness. It is an attitude that God doesn't exist, or if he exists, that he doesn't really matter very much in our lives. When Alexander Solzhenitsyn looked at the shambles Russian society made of itself, he summarized the whole problem in just 4 words by saying, men have forgotten God. So we can see that even the man realized that the whole shambles that this Russian society have got themselves into was just because men have forgotten God. Now that applies to other societies as well, not just Russian society, even the whole world today, including ours. Men have forgotten God. This means that every type of moralizing, every effort to make individuals more virtuous, or to make a society more decent, isn't addressing the real problem at all. It's like using a band-aid on a gunshot wound. or taking two aspirin to get rid of cancer. No, that would just be futility. We don't just need a little something to deal with the particular first symptom of wickedness. We need somehow to be saved from God's wrath and turned from godlessness back to God. So nothing less would do. Who? Me? Well, you know, well, like, is it me that is the problem? Okay, now let's see. Let's take another look at the scenario in Romans 1. This time in reverse order. The final verses show the dregs of degradation, where people are so brazen that they openly approve and encourage evil. That's what we see when we look at that last chapter, last verses of that Romans 1. Isn't this happening right now? Gossip isn't condemned. It's a multi-billion dollar industry of trash TV and tabloids. Sexual perversion isn't condemned. It's a multi-billion dollar industry of pornographic magazines and movies. Abortion isn't condemned by those in power. They promote it and help pay for it. Mixed up families and rebellious youth are no laughing matter. But we laughed anyway at stupid sitcoms that mock the family. Watch those TV programs. Strive and Mother are glorified in fame and after fame. The fashion world even gets into the act, peddling to kids everywhere the style of clothes that gang members wear and encouraging girls to dress like prostitutes. You see, children watching this kind of programs on TV, is, you see, most times these are some of the problems that we have, even in our social medias and the internet, the TV that we watch. Many times you see people doing those things in TV, and then that's what our children watch, or ourselves, that is what we watch, and these are the things that we want to copy, which is not actually good. We know God's decree of death against such wickedness, but we flaunt it anyway. It's the kind of situation God describes in Jeremiah, where he says, are they ashamed of their loathsome conduct? No, they have no shame at all. They do not even know how to blush, Jeremiah 8:12. But maybe you say, who? Me? That's not my attitude at all. Maybe you're concerned about this open contempt for decency and this lust of conscience. You're troubled by the breakdown of families and the violence in society. You'd like to see more love and peace. Meanwhile, though you're still convinced there's nothing wrong with sex between consenting adults, you think it's okay as long as it doesn't hurt anybody else. But Romans 1 says, and history shows, that this attitude towards sex is part of the same deadly chain reaction which produces the violence and heartless behavior you dislike so much. And anyway, how can you say it doesn't hurt anybody when so many people are dying of AIDS and other diseases, as Romans puts it? They receive in their own bodies the due penalty for their perversion. But maybe you recognize this. You're troubled by the promotion of gay lifestyles and the widespread promiscuity, divorce and destruction of marriages. You're concerned about that. You wish more people would get back additional morality. But you're non-committal when it comes to faith in God. In fact, you believe an evolutionary theory about human origin that doesn't say much of anything about God, or you believe that the universe itself is divine. But Romans 1 says, and history shows, that accepting and spreading such belief has a devastating impact on sexual morality. Once again, despite your intentions, you're part of the problem, not part of the solution. But maybe you don't accept any of the evils we've been talking about. You're concerned about crime and societal strife. You support traditional sexual morality. You believe in God and you think everybody should be taught about creation. But when it comes to your day-to-day living, you don't pay much attention to God. You don't marvel at His majesty. And you don't thank Him for the good things He sends into your life. If that's the case, then you're an atheist in your behavior, even if you're not an atheist in your mind. There's no use believing in God if you don't honor Him as God and give Him thanks. Many of us just live our life like that. We just live a normal life. We don't think about the place of God. We just want to just live the life and just to suit you. But the truth is, you might not call yourself an atheist, but by your behavior, you're behaving like an atheist. And that brings us back to where we started. Romans 1 says that even though God makes himself known to us, we don't glorify him or give him thanks. We don't respond to God's kindness and love by loving him in return. That's where all the trouble starts. The heart of the problem turns out to be a problem of the heart. Once our heart refuses to love and worship and thank God, our heads begin to suppress what we know about him, and our hands start doing things that show how far we are from God. So let's not fool ourselves. Let's not say, who, me? You and I are implicated in all this. Some of us who still have some sense of morality or some religious loyalty would like to think otherwise. But right after Romans 1 describes the deadly generation that results from ignoring God and provoking his wrath, the very next statement is this: you therefore have no excuse. You will pass judgment on someone else, for at whatever point you judge the other, you are condemning yourself, because you will pass judgment and do the same thing as Romans 22 verse 1. We do the very things that we condemn in others, even if we don't commit the exact crime of sin. We're still up to our neck in the whole situation, whether you're a person who flaunts the most less of antisocial behavior, or someone who considers yourself basically nice but with a preference for sexual freedom, or a person who wants things to improve and thinks qualities comes without God can make it happen, or the respectable type of person who helps on virtue and morality all day long, you're part of the mess described in Romans 1, and you're under the wrath of God. Now, what's the solution? We've seen the problem. See what we are in today, but there is a solution that is because of it. And with that solution, a lot of concerned people are saying that we need a stronger emphasis on morality. Maybe so, but if that's all we have, it will just make the situation worse. A stronger emphasis on morality will make some people even more rebellious against authority and make the rest of us hypocrites. Why? Because as we talk about morals, we commit the ultimate immorality of ignoring God in our everyday life and suppressing anything we know about God. That we don't happen to find convenient. Sorry, let me take that statement again. Because as we talk about morals, we commit the same ultimate immorality of ignoring God in our everyday life and suppressing anything we know about God. That we don't happen to find convenient. A stronger emphasis on moral absolutes is not our greatest need. Our greatest need is to see our degenerating situation as a revelation of God's word, and to realize that the deadly chain reaction will continue unless we are rescued from God's word, changed at the very heart of who we are, and restored to fellowship with the God we've tried so hard to. There have been various attempts to say that people aren't really so bad, that all they need is a little more instruction in morality. Even some churches have downplayed talk about sin and God's wrath and Jesus' blood as the only way to be saved, and have said that people just need better role models and more information and education and life. Can anyone take such thinking seriously? The Bible's diagnosis of the situation is 100% accurate, and the Bible's solution is the only one that's going to work. What's the solution? Nothing less than the power of God himself, unleashed in the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Romans 1, just before the Apostle Paul describes the deadly chain reaction of ignoring God, he writes, "I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is the power of God for the salvation of everyone who believes, first for the Jew, then for the Gentile. For in the gospel, a righteousness from God is revealed, a righteousness that is by faith from first to last, just as it is written, the righteous will live by faith. That's Romans chapter 1, verse 16 to 17. Paul was enthusiastic about the gospel because he knew that Christ is our only hope. Writing to people who lived in Rome, the capital city of the world, the capital city of the world's greatest power, superpower, Paul could have been intimidated by the trapping of culture and power. But Paul saw through all that to a society that was rotting at its very core. The situation in ancient Rome was much like ours. Rome's only hope was the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, and that is still our only hope today. If our future depends on our virtue or on our ability to turn our lives around, the situation is hopeless. But the gospel introduces us to God's cleansing power in Jesus' blood and God's life-giving power in Jesus' resurrection. And the gospel calls us to faith in Christ. God's mercy in Jesus Christ, that is the gospel. That is the power of God for salvation to everyone who has faith. Just as the source of all our problems is alienated from God, so the solution to our problem is restored fellowship with God. So what we're saying here is that the solution to this problem that we find ourselves in our society today is restored fellowship with God, going back to God, giving God the glory. I haven't given a very flattering picture of where we are or where we're headed in our flight from God. That's not because I like making people feel rough, but because it's God's truth, and the sooner we face it, the better. The Bible shows that apart from a great rebirth through the gospel of Christ, things go from bad to worse. Without regeneration, there's only degeneration. Let's close with a humble, heartbroken prayer from the Bible. A prayer of sinners who have provoked God's wrath, who have been given over to ever-increasing sin and ruin, and who now long for His mercy and salvation. Join me as we pray. Lord, look down from heaven and see from the lofty throne, holy and glorious. You come to the help of those who gladly do right, who remember your words. But when we continue to sin against them, you will answer. How then can we be saved? All of us have become unclean, and all our righteous acts are like filthy rags. You have hidden your face from us and made us waste away because of our sins. Yet, O Lord, you are our Father. We are the clay, you are the potter. We are all the work of your hand. Do not be angry beyond measure. O Lord, do not remember our sins forever. Oh, look upon us, we pray. For we are all your people. Forgive us and save us through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Now, I have just read to us what was prepared by David Fettis. It was originally prepared by him for back to God Ministry International to expose to us the situation that we are. I did that because we're actually looking at fellowship with God. We looked at the problem, the situation we find ourselves today, and we have seen the only solution. We realize that the only solution is having restored fellowship with God, and that is what this book is all about, fellowship with God. Now let's proceed with this book after seeing the deadly chain reaction that has brought us under God's rules. But praise be to God, it can be changed if only we will return back to God. And this is why this book. So we want to encourage you to remain connected to us. Always go through our page on Facebook, Citizens of Zion. We believe you have a good time there. It contains spiritual nuggets and you need to stir up that passion deep within you to fellowship.